We have with us Pallikonda Manikanta, who's standing for the position of General Secretary from BABSA. Our first question to you would be to sort of give us some outline about the manifesto and the program that BABSA has in mind in case it's when its candidates win, and how it is different from other organizations.
Basically, this time Birsa Ambedkar Phule Student Association has come up with the agenda, larger agenda of the oppressed unity. So it is not just a, you know, it's not just an electoral alliance, but a larger, you know, socio-cultural, ideological alliance, which was, you know, we have started from past 2 years with other our, you know, natural allies in these oppressed communities, especially United OPC Forum, SIO, JTSA and YFDA in this campus. But you know, as this manifesto, this oppressed manifesto this time which we have released, in that our first demand or first agenda, you know, with regard to this racial docile, which has come up recently, which states that all the Northeast students and the Kashmiris, Dalit and the Muslim students, you know, they have labeled them as the anti-nationals, and they have, you know, they are involving continuously in the sex racket. So here few professors, especially Amita Singh from CSLG Center, who became controversial. She was one among them. And you know, our major demand in this manifesto is to suspend all the professors who have, you know, drafted the this Brahminical racial docile. And second, with regard to the minority deprivation points who are socially and educationally backward. Because this campus, you know, especially in this cow belt area, the Muslims in this campus, the Muslims are, you know, the especially Muslims in the minority communities are, you know, clearly ghettoized. And it happens at several levels. Like, you know, you find most of the Muslim students only in few departments in the School of Languages. We want to question, like, why this, you know, this thing is happening. And this minority deprivation points is not just, ki, you know, in a way, ki telling if, you know, they have minority deprivation points, then only, you know, the people come here and study. But it's a constitutional right, and so we are demanding. And the other thing is regarding the, in preventing this hidden discriminatory forms in this campus. JNU is known for its radical student movement from past few years. But now the current example, if we take, one side there is this shutdown JNU, and other side, you know, the stand with JNU. And now people are, you know, telling you this stand with JNU is a larger movement of social justice, and it's a larger movement of, you know, ensuring justice and equality, so on. But we want to question how, you know, the stand with JNU movement represents the entire nation. Because when a student comes from, you know, far away from 2,000, 3,000 kilometers and comes here to study in JNU, it doesn't, you know, it means ki, you know, this sort of institutions we are lacking in our states, and the primary education is not, you know, it's not well established in our, at the village level. When we come, you know, when we do MPhil from state universities and come here for PhD, the, you know, the especially the elite sections or so-called, you know, these upper caste sections, they do, you know, MA and BA here, and they directly go to abroad. Then we can see, you know, this variation in these educational institutions. So in this regard, our you know, major demand, especially enacting the Rohit Act. So our major demand is to, or our major agenda is to fight for the Rohit Act, so that, you know, all this hidden discriminatory process in the state universities, in the central universities, will be annihilated. And there are many other issues, especially hostel issue, which becomes a buzzword every year. But we want to question, when, you know, there are lot of, when in the name of development, the Adivasis, you know, their survival, you know, is questioned when, you know, this development discourse comes. And for building many projects, for building many dams, they easily get the environmental clearance. But, you know, we are not able to understand in JNU to construct a hostel, why it takes so much time to just, you know, to get an environmental clearance. So it's a clear hypocrisy from this upper caste, male North Indian lethargic bureaucratic work which is there in this JNU. And also, you know, it's a very passive casteist student union culture which exists on this campus. And this campus is not disabled friendly, this campus is not LGBTIQ friendly, and this campus is not women friendly at all. So we are questioning all this hidden discriminatory process at every level, and this everyday forms of resistance which we perform in our everyday life of struggle, we are consolidating this everyday forms of resistance, and this oppressed unity is resemblance of it.
With the march a few nights ago, and now there is so much momentum around a lot of the Baksa candidates, we just want to go back and talk to you about what kind of response you got when you decided to not join the so-called progressive forces. You said we are going to fight our elections by ourselves. The response you got from teachers, from the student body, from karmcharis and stuff. So a little bit about that.
First, I'll start with the negative response or the rumors that started spreading on Bapsas contesting in this election. Anti-ABVP discourse or the threat of ABVP coming into the power, you know, which was created by the so-called left unity this time. You know, it clearly, you know, they have they started saying that Bapsa is contesting, then you know ABVP will come. So in order to prevent ABVP, you know, coming into the JNSU, winning in the JNSU, then vote for left. Now we want to question only one thing: why it is always on our burden, why it is always on the oppressed section's burden that we have to come to form the alliances, or we have to form the larger, you know, broader alliance or whatever progressive alliances. See, in this campus, you know, this politics of language which they play. They say left, democratic, progressive organizations. In not even a single parcha or not even a single day-to-day discourse, they mention the word of Ambedkar. So we want to question what problem you have in mentioning, you know, there are Ambedkarite organizations exist on this campus. And now we are asking this straight question: Bapsa or the larger Ambedkarite movement or the larger anti-caste movement, let's say, in this country and in this campus especially, our aim, you know, our day-to-day struggle is to fight against these Brahminical forces. And how you can claim, or how you can tell, you know, our contesting in, you know, in this election will give rise to the, you know, the rise of the ABVP. And now we are telling, you know, annihilating ABVP in this campus is it means that stopping this pseudo left group politics, because if ABVP is not there, then left can't survive, because they won't be having any issues at all. So they fear that if Bapsa contests in this election, then sure, you know, there is a larger threat to the both left and right. Then, you know, they fear for our discourse. You know, they are scared of our discourse. They are scared of our unity. They are scared of the larger, you know, this alternative pedagogy which is coming, which went unnoticed all these years. And the positive response from the different oppressed communities, especially the Muslim communities and the Northeast students, you know, which is, you know, in a larger way, it's coming. And also here, from the workers, like especially in the life science, when we went in the School of Life Sciences for this campaign, the non-teaching faculty were very happy ki till now, you know, like we did not see any organization. It's not that, you know, there was no Ambedkarite movement in this campus. There was Ambedkarite movement in this campus, and now Bapsa is taking forward it. And they were so happy ki, you know, now this, you know, Ambedkarite movement is coming, and you know, it's becoming so much visible, and this discourse of oppressed unity is coming forward. And also the karmacharis especially, you know, they have many problems, especially the contract workers. And you know, when we have talked with them with regard to their problems, like they don't have any safety measures, though, you know, there will be official like parchas or official notices from the contractor side, you know, we are you know, there will be a notice saying, कि यू नो यू पीपल हैव टू वेयर ग्लव द सेफ्टी ग्लव्स और सेफ्टी मेजर्स बट इन रियलिटी वॉट हैपन्स इज दिस कॉन्ट्रैक्टर डजेंट सप्लाई ऑल दोज यू नो सेफ्टी मेजर्स टू द वर्कर सो दे यू नो दे हैव कम एंड कंप्लेन टू अस एंड देन वी हैव रिस्पॉन्डेड इट एंड नाउ दे आर लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड इफ यू नो बक्सा कम्स इन टू पावर देन स्पेशली यू नो द कर्मचारीज एंड द नॉन टीचिंग्स एंड ऑल्सो द फैकल्टी बिकॉज हियर द रिक्रूटमेंट वी हैव लेस यू नो वेरी फ्यू OBC professors. We have very few scheduled caste professors and we have very few scheduled tribe professors, not even only in JNU, even in Central University like HCU and many other universities, we won't be finding, you know, the professors from these communities. And we are, we are rejecting this not found suitable wala drama, which every time, this Brahminical intelligentsia takes and rejects the merit of the oppressed sections.